praise and worship this morning. Wasn't that awesome this morning?
Yes.
Felt the Spirit of the Lord just flowing all the way from the front to the back. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Turn your Bibles, if you will, to Psalms 120. Praise God. Psalms 120. Psalms 121. Psalms 122. Psalms 123. And Psalms 124. And I'm so glad folks, God's been so good to every one of us. And, He said He'd always be there for us. He'd never leave us nor forsake us, Brother Bill. Amen, sister. Amen. We'll go with this all the way, even to the end of the world. So, in the Word of the Lord, think about David for a minute. And Bert has done, of course, a marvelous job teaching Bible class here on Sunday mornings. And if you really want to get some powerful word, come to that first hour if you can and hear Brother Bert teach. Amen? Because he does a great job. Amen. And he gets into the word of the Lord. David, of course, is the king of Israel. And we know that from him comes the lineage to Jesus Christ. And so it's very important that the bloodline not be interrupted. I mean, it's critical to God. The reason God destroyed the earth in the first place in the flood is because he looked upon the earth. He saw that all flesh was corrupted. It was very important. And I actually did some research on that. You had the giants that were before the flood and after the flood. We know that it says the sons of God looked upon the daughters of men, saw that they were fair. That's the fallen ones. In other words, Lucifer's fallen angels looked upon the daughters of men and saw they were fair, and came in among them, and they bore them children, men of great renown. Giants then filled the earth. Okay, there was a lot of these giants. So they were what's known as Nephilim, or hybrid, or whatever you want to say. But they were of a corrupt seed. They had corrupted the flesh. And so I did some study. I said, well, Lord, how in the world? But if you study Noah, the Bible says, but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. So God found a pure bloodline. And he was a man of righteousness, a preacher of righteousness. And so through that, Noah and his wife, his three sons, and their wives entered into the ark. Now the ark was open for all humanity, but man refused to accept God's precious gift. So we know what happens is Noah goes through the flood. God brings him through. Paul explains it and says, through faith, Noah moved with fear, preparing an ark to the saving of eight souls. I think it says in the book of Hebrews 11. So in other words, he moved by fear because he received the word from the Lord that God said, I am going to destroy the earth, period. And I need you to build an ark. And I understand you're 500 years old, but that's too bad. You got to build an ark. It's going to take you a little over 100 years to build it. And here's the blueprints. You're going to use gopher wood. And you're going to build it exactly the way I give you the dimensions, with three levels in it, with one door and one window at the top. And as a matter of fact, that door was in the second level. And praise the Lord for this, because we know that Jesus said, for the kingdom of heaven is like three measures of meal. All right? That's hidden. And the ark had three levels in it. And you can look at this. We have the Old Testament, if you will. We have the time of Jesus Christ. And then we have the New Testament covenant. So look at Jesus being in the middle. He's the door into the sheepfold. He is the door. He's in the second level of the ark. And the Holy Spirit would fall on the third dispensation. That's of the church, or the new covenant church. Isn't that awesome? So even when God was designing the ark, he was doing more than designing a physical ark. He was designing a spiritual ark for the fallen humanity, to make a way where there seems to be no way.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. It's just awesome. Right there, you just shout, I guess. I mean, when I study the word. And here's what happens, though. But then after that, we understand that things begin to develop. There begins to be more problems take place. Of course, sin is still in the world. And we have issues that take place. Finally, God is, the children of Israel wind up, of course, Abraham gets the covenant with God. His son Isaac carries on the promise. His son Jacob then has 12 sons. They become the 12 tribes of Israel. And the 11 brothers sell out, basically 10, sell out the one brother, Joseph. with the coat of many colors and put him into a pit. They sell him to the a band that come along, and they went into Egypt and sold him on the slave block, where he was bought by a man named Potiphar. And Potiphar then made him a slave working for him. But the Bible says that everything Joseph touched was blessed, and Potiphar became very wealthy. We know the whole story. He ends up in the prison before coming out, and ended up in the palace. And the dreams of the king, and how he's able to interpret the dreams, becomes the governor of Egypt. We have the 7 years of great abundance, and then the 7 years of famine. But in the midst of the famine, the children of Egypt prospered because they had followed the word of the Lord and been delivered. Okay, so that's why they prospered. And we know that then Jacob and his children have run out of food, and they have to send some of the boys over to Egypt to find out. They hear there's food there. They end up in slavery before it's all over. They had sold their brother there, and when you sell your brother there, you wind up there yourself. Come on, let me preach here today. Some folks will say, I'm trying to get rid of that brother. I'm trying to sell him out, trying to get rid of him. You sell out a brother, you end up in the pit. You'll end up in prison. It might take a few years. It might take a few months. It might take a few weeks. But you'll wind up there. Praise the Lord. So that's why we don't do that. As Christians, we love our brothers and sisters in Christ. And we lift each other up. And we'll even cover it. The Bible says that perfect love casts out fear. But it also says that love will cover a multitude of sins. Can you say amen? So now we're got out of Egypt. Now they're in Egypt. Now they get in slavery. We go through these 400 years. Moses comes along, delivers the children of Israel, gets them out of there through the Passover. Then they wander around in the wilderness 40 years because they murmured and complained for 40 days when they were told that they could take the land of Canaan. But who was standing in the way? Those same giants that caused the whole mess in the first place in Genesis 6 show up again as different tribes, whether they're the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Jebusites, the Moabites, the Amorites, all of them, and they all were giants, basically, different tribes. But praise God, Joshua takes the children of Israel across the Jordan River, and the Lord's hand is upon them, and they begin to conquer the enemy and take what the Lord had originally promised to Abraham in the first covenant, that I will leave your country and among your kin and go to a country that I'm going to show you where it's at. Praise the Lord. I'm going to send you to a promised land. And that's the same thing for the body of Christ. I've never seen heaven. I've never got a glimpse of it. I don't know how to get there, but I know one thing. By faith, I'm still looking for a city whose builder and maker is God. Can you say amen? Yeah. I'm going to heaven. How about you?
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. We can say that by faith. Not by anything that we can do, because we can't earn it. We can't buy it. We can't. And we got to just follow Jesus to get there. Praise the Lord. Now we know what else happens to children of Israel. Once they get there, they decide they want their own king. They had their prophets. The prophets was leading them in the right direction. But they saw that the other nations around them had kings. And so they started complaining to Samuel that they wanted a king. And so then God said, all right, give them a king. And so they chose Saul. Saul was a big man, about 6'5". He stood head and shoulders above all the children of Israel. They chose him. He's a mighty warrior. He was a big man. He's strong. He was a leader. Okay? And so he becomes the king of Israel. But he wasn't. And he even gets anointed by Samuel. And God says, all right, I'm going to let you do it. It's not my best. But since you want to go that route, I'll work with you. But if you're going to have kings, you need to have a king of the lineage of Christ.
Amen.
And Saul wasn't. And so what God did is he looked upon, and that's why Jesse had 8 sons, and the youngest of those was David, who was taking care of his father's sheep. It was David who had a heart. The Bible says he was a man after God's own heart. Praise the Lord. It is David who was taking care of the sheep that killed the lion and the bear that tried to devour the little lambs. It was David who would be standing before Goliath and would remove him from his position of authority over the children of Israel. It was David who would be anointed king by Samuel, who would eventually wind up as the king of Israel. And David is from the tribe of Judah, and from his lineage would come Jesus Christ through a virgin girl by the name of Mary. And Christ Jesus would be born in Bethlehem, and praise the Lord, hope for humanity would be restored, would be granted through the grace of God's mercy, because he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever everlasting life. And that's how we got saved, because we believe in him. Now, this same David, it was not always a bed of roses for him. And so he had a lot of obstacles, and there was a lot of bloodshed even in his own kingdom. And he had problems among his own family. He had issues among the servants he had. Even the former king threw javelins at him and sent armies after him and tried to hunt him down. And so let's go to Psalms 120 and see what David writes. He says, "In my distress, I cried unto the Lord, and he heard me." Can you say amen?
Amen.
I'm so glad you can do that. He hears you. "Deliver my soul, O Lord, from lying lips and from the deceitful tongue. What shall be given unto thee? Or what shall be done unto thee, thou false tongue?" So in other words, people were lying. They were trying to, they were trying to disrupt the fact that David is the king of Israel. They were trying to stop him. "Sharp arrows of the mighty with coals of juniper. Woe is me that I sojourn in Meshach, that I dwell in the tents of Kedar. My soul hath long dwelt with him that hateth peace. I am for peace, but when I speak, they are for war." I'm going to ask you a question. As a Christian, we're humble. We are humble people. We really just want to do the work of Christ. We just want to help people. We just want to lead people to Jesus. We want to show them the way of salvation. If they're sick, we want them to be healed. But and so I know about, I mean, most of you, I guarantee you, as a Christian, you were born of God. You're born of love. Can you say amen?
Amen.
And so that's really your heart's desire. You become as humble as a child, and if you don't, you can't see the kingdom of heaven. You can't enter into the kingdom of heaven. Yet, at times, I find myself at war with the devil.
Amen.
Matter of fact, all the time, I seem like I'm in war with the devil. I don't want to go to war. I didn't get saved to go to war. I got saved to have peace. Okay? Am I right?
Amen.
Jesus said that the peace that I give you is not the peace of the world, but what the peace that I give you passes all understanding. So even though you find yourself wanting to do the works of Christ and do positive things and show humbleness and love, you will find yourself in the middle of a spiritual battle every time you turn around.
Amen.
You need to know the enemy is against you. The blood of but the blood of Christ is against the devil. Praise
Amen.
The Lord.
Praise the Lord.
But the enemy is against you. He is not for what you're doing. He doesn't leave you alone just because you're a child of God. He doesn't say, well, there's no need to fool with that one. No, because of the fact that you are a child of God and you are taking ground for the kingdom of God, because you are showing love, because you are compassionate, because you are shining the light, because you're trying to do the right thing, the devil is against you. Praise the Lord. And so I used to work for this guy a long time ago, matter of fact. And he was he owned this company, about $40 million company, I guess it was. I worked 5 years for him. And I called him in the morning. He lived in California. And I would call him in the morning and tell him, give him an update of what we were going to do at the plant during the day. And I would say, good morning, how you doing? He said, oh, I don't know. I'm going to war today. I said, okay, who you fighting? I'm fighting everybody. I'm fighting the vendors. I'm fighting the bankers. I'm fighting the customers. I'm even fighting my employees. I said, okay, I got stuff to do. I'll see you later. No, no. In other words, in his mind, every morning, his kingdom, if you will, his company that he owned, for him to maintain it, he had to go to war with everybody, including those that were on his side. But he seen them as an enemy, as somebody has to pay that maybe is not providing enough service for the pay. He's seen the vendor, even though the vendors were shipping the products that he needed to make money, if they were charging too much or their terms were too long, he's seen them as an enemy of his business. He's seen the bankers, even though he had to borrow money maybe to do a capital investment, he's still seen the banker as potentially his enemy. He even seen the competition, certainly, who were trying to get the same space out in the world, in the retail shelving. Certainly, I can see where he would see that the competitors might be his enemy, but he even saw the customer as enemy. It was just amazing to me. I thought, how in the world does this guy function every day, getting up every day, thinking that everybody's against him? Here's the good news as a Christian. Not everybody's against you. Just the devil. Really, that's it. Just him. He is against you. I guarantee it. But praise God. Praise the Lord. If God be for you, who can be against you?
Amen. Praise God.
to stand up against you? If Christ be for you, if God be for you, who can be against you? In other words, who is able to stand against the voice of God? Who is able to penetrate the blood of Jesus Christ? Who is able to come against the power of the Holy Ghost? I'm here to tell you, there's nobody, there's no force on the planet that's able to penetrate the promises of God's Word. There's nothing that can come against you that can defeat you. Continue to walk in the blessing of God. Keep living every day for the Lord. Keep going forward. Recognize the devil's out there. He's a roaring lion. He's seeking whom he may devour. Know that he's out there and that he's fighting you and he's your adversary. Even Peter said, my adversary, the devil, praise the Lord. He's like a roaring lion. He's seeking whom he can devour. He's going to fight you. But praise God, greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Amen. You're conquerors. You're more than conquerors through Christ that strengthens you. Now David is realizing that even though I am for peace, but when I speak, they are for war. In 121, he says, I will lift up my eyes unto the hills from whence cometh my help. Praise the Lord. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Praise God. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. Amen. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth, even forevermore. That is an awesome verse. That's an awesome chapter. It's a promise. So the Lord's going to be with you, Bill, no matter what. No matter what. It could be a little dark. Things could be a little tough. You may feel all alone. You may feel that something's went wrong. Maybe you've gotten sick. Maybe the situation's come upon you. Maybe there's a situation taking place in your life, in your community, in your job. But know this, the Lord's word is absolutely guaranteed in Psalms 121 that the Lord will not even let your foot slip. Praise God. And then in Psalms 122, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. He didn't say, well, I dreaded this Sunday. Okay? He didn't. David didn't say, well, I guess I gotta go. No. David said, I was glad when they said, look, if you fight the devil 6 days a week, you want to go to the house of the Lord where you can praise his name. I mean, when you fight with the devil every day, can you say amen? I mean, I'm punching and kicking and pulling his hair and shoving him around and doing everything as he's battling us every day. Praise God. I'm glad when they say, let's go to the house of the Lord. Amen. I was glad when they said, let me go. Because I know he's going to have a hard time getting in the presence of the Holy Ghost. He's going to have a difficult issue when people are sitting in the pews in love with one another, hugging one another, praising the Lord during the praise and worship, and the Spirit of God begins to fill the house. It's hard for the devil to get a foothold when you're in the presence of the Lord. David said, I was glad when they said, let's go to the house of the Lord.
Amen.
It's going to be tough on the devil to deal with the praises of the Lord. The Bible says, for the Lord inhabits the praise of his people. It's praise God. If two of you would agree, touching any one thing, it shall be done. But get this, if two or three of you would gather in my name, I'll be in the midst. And so the devil realizes that when people come together into the house of the Lord to lift up the praises of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, that praise God, that Jesus Christ will be in the midst. When we start to pray at the altar or in our seats or where we are, when we begin to pray in what we call corporate prayer, all of us praying at the same time, the power of God is amazing. And the devil can't do a thing with it. And if the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much, think how powerful it is when the congregation of the Lord Jesus Christ comes together in the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Of the Lord. Our feet shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem. Jerusalem! Jerusalem is built as a city that is compact together. Whither the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, unto the testimony of Israel, to give thanks unto the name of the Lord. I will... Woo! Glory, praise the Lord. His name is Emmanuel, God with us. He's the wonderful counselor, the Almighty God, the Prince of Peace. He is El Shaddai, Lord God Almighty. He's Jehovah Rapha. He is the God that healeth thee. Praise the Lord, Jehovah Jireh. He's the provider. He's Jehovah Shalom. He is our peace. He's Jehovah Nissi. He's our banner. Can you say amen?
Yeah.
There's power in his name. Jesus Christ of Nazareth, or Jesus Cristo, or maybe Yeshua, whatever, however you want to say his name. Believe me, he knows who he is, and he knows who you're praising. Call upon the name of Jesus Christ. Can you say that? And so, my Spanish not real good, so forgive me on that one. Praise the Lord. Whether the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, unto the testimony of Israel, to give thanks unto the name of the Lord. For there are set thrones of judgment, the thrones of the house of David. And you can actually run that back in Deuteronomy or go over to 2 Chronicles. It talks about the thrones of David. Not just his throne, but the thrones. In other words, he was given even more authority than just the very throne he sat on. Praise God, that's another study. Peace, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. They shall prosper that love thee. I've had folks write me, Pastor, I don't know, how do I be blessed? I get an email like that or a letter. Pastor, tell me, how do I be blessed? Well, my first thing to say to you is pray for the peace of Jerusalem.
Amen.
You shall prosper. And the Bible also says, you know, if you be obedient to the work of the Lord, if in your giving and in your faithfulness, you will be blessed. What, and matter of fact, blessed is a man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, or sitteth in the way of, sitteth in the seat of the scornful, or standeth in the way of sinners. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in that law he doth meditate day and night. He's like a tree planted by the rivers of water; he shall not be moved. His leaf shall not wither, and whatever he puts his hand to shall prosper. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Folks will say, I don't understand. How come this individual here, this person over there, is prospering so well? They're following the word. Can you say amen?
Amen.
And so God said he wants to bless us, and he wants to keep us, and he wants to give us the joy. The greatest blessing there is the joy of the Lord.
Yes.
It's your strength.
Amen.
And a merry heart maketh like a medicine.
Amen.
You want to know why Dad's feeling good this morning? Because he's got joy. Praise the Lord.
Yeah,
the joy of the Lord is your strength. The joy of the Lord. The name of the Lord. Praise the Lord. Get up some morning before you even get your first cup of coffee and just say, well, praise the Lord, glory to God. I'm going to have a great day. Thank you. Praise your holy name. I'm so glad, Father, you got me up again. Kept me through the night, slept well. Now you've opened my eyes to see the dawning of a new day. Well, I think I'm going to praise the Lord. And I'm putting two scoops of coffee into that filter. Hey, praise God. Hallelujah. This is the day the Lord has made. Let's rejoice and be glad. I promise you, when you start your day getting out of bed, instead of mumbling and complaining and murmuring and saying, you're not going to have a good day. I praise the Lord. But if you come out shouting, if you come out dancing like my mama does, if you come out to the kitchen in there and say, well, praise God, I feel good today in the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Right? Praise the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Yes, praise God. And then Jesus, immediately, the angels in heaven wake up with you. Praise God. They wake up and say, whoa, there's somebody down there praising the name of the Lord. God sits on his majestic throne. His son sitting to the right of him says, do you hear the praise coming from that little hallway in that house? Do you hear that praise in the kitchen table? Did you hear them call upon your name? Praise the Lord. David knew the power of the name of God, and he would declare it above everyone, because God, if God be for you, again, Paul said, who can be against you?
Amen.
I was glad, he said, when they said, go to the house of the Lord. And then let's skip on that. Where am I at? 122 verse 6. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. They shall prosper that love thee. Peace be within thy walls, and prosperity within thy palaces. Praise God. For my brethren and companions' sake, I will now say, peace be unto thee. Wow. Praise the Lord. Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek thy good. Praise the Lord. It's important to go to church on Sunday, or whichever day of the week you go, or whatever night of the week you go, or whenever you decide to go, anytime you get an opportunity to go to the house of the Lord, you will leave different than you come in.
Amen.
You will leave with an anointing in your life.
Amen.
The devil knows it. That's why on Sunday morning he tries to cause you to be back sore and grumbling, and he don't want you in here, because he knows if you get in here with these other Bible-believing, altar-thumping, pew-jumping Christians, he knows if you get in here and start singing, "Blessed be the name of the Lord," he says, "Oh no," because that means when they leave here, oh, I don't want him to hear the Word of God. Don't want to hear the preachers. Don't want you to preach the Word of God, because if you preach the Word, the power of God will not only surge through you, but it will go and reunite and accomplish where God sends it, and it will not return void. Can you say that? The devil knows this, and he says, "I got to stop that. I got to try to put an end to that. I got to go to war against that, because I know that if they get started, then I can't do anything with them." Praise the Lord.
Amen.
That's why you get in your car when this service is over. Hug somebody out in the yard. Tell them how much you love them. You get in the car. You'll be singing one of the songs as you're going home. Praise the Lord. Pop it in a CD and listening to it and praising the Lord. And you'll just feel better all day, because you've been in the presence of an almighty God.
Amen.
And that's why the Bible says this for those of you studying the end time Bible prophecy. Fail not the assembling of yourselves together, and even the more so when you see the day approaching. In the last days, we need more of God, not less.
Amen.
We need more of His Word, not less.
Amen.
We need more prayer, not less.
Amen.
We need more love, not less.
Amen.
We need more joy, not less.
Amen.
We need all of God, not less. Praise the Lord. And so the more of God you put into your life, the more you allow Him to be free in your life, the more the Lord will bless you. For my brethren and companions' sake, I will now say, peace be unto thee. Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek thy good. Let's go to Psalms 123. Unto thee lift I up my eyes, O thou that dwellest in the heavens. Behold, as the eyes of servants look into the hand of their masters, and as the eyes of the maiden unto the hand of her mistress, so our eyes wait upon the Lord our God until that He hath mercy on us. Praise the Lord. Amen. Have mercy on us, O Lord. Have mercy on us, for we are exceedingly filled with contempt. Our soul is exceedingly filled with the scorning of those that are at ease and with the contempt of the proud. We're under pressure, Lord. We're being persecuted, Lord. We're being talked about. We're being lied on. God, I'm waiting on you, praise the Lord, because I know you can renew my strength. You can help me to mount up on wings of eagles. Praise the Lord. And then look at 124. If it had not been the Lord who was on our side, now may Israel say, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side when men rose up against us, then they had swallowed us up quick when their wrath was kindled against us. They would have defeated us. They were always outnumbered. Israel's always been outnumbered. There's no way Israel could defeat. Do you realize right now that just the nation of Israel is like a slither, it's just a little small little slither. It's the size of Rhode Island. And yet surrounding Israel are major nations who want to annihilate it. And they have said it. They prophesy. They have their Quran and other books that they quote. There's 250 million Muslims completely surrounding this one little land, piece of land that was promised to who? Abraham. I just told them in the beginning. Abraham, he said, I promise you, you can't take out God's promise. Can you say amen?
Amen.
I don't care if the whole world comes against you. Praise the Lord. You can't stop the promise of God.
Amen.
And so, David says, if the Lord hadn't been on our side, basically, we would have been done. Verse 4, then the waters had overwhelmed us at the Red Sea. The stream had gone over our soul. Then the proud waters had gone over our soul. Blessed be the Lord, who hath not given us as a prey to their teeth. Our soul has escaped as a bird out of the snare of the fowlers. The snare is broken, and we are escaped. I love it. The snare is broken, and we are escaped. The devil's back is broken, and we go free. Praise God. The chains, Paul and Silas, in that Philippine jail, had nobody to go their bail. But praise the Lord, at the midnight hour, after it had already been beaten and had many stripes laid upon them, praise God, and had been put in the inner prison, praise the Lord. The Bible says at midnight, Paul and Silas sang praises unto the Lord. They prayed and sang praises unto God. And the Bible says the foundation of the prison was shaken, praise God. Oh, hallelujah. And every band and every prison chain broke loose. And not only of Paul and Silas, but every prisoner in the prison got set free. And this is one time Elvis was right. They had a jailhouse rock, praise God. Everybody got set free, praise the Lord. And the prisoner was going to, the keeper of the jail pulled a sword and was going to take his own life. And Paul sprung into life and said, do thyself no harm, for we're all here. Can you say amen?
Amen.
We're just having a jailhouse rock. Praise God. Amen. In Jesus' name. Who's the rock? Jesus Christ. All right. So blessed be the Lord who hath not given us as a prey to their teeth. Our soul has escaped as a bird out of the snare of the fowlers, because the snare is broken and we are escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Who hath made heaven and earth.
Amen.
That's who's on our side.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Amen. I want to ask you to stand. Praise the Lord all over the building as they come get a song. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. Preacher's going to come forward, and I don't know, maybe everybody here is saved, and God knows every heart. He knows all of you. I feel a good anointing, a good spirit of the Lord here today. Don't you, Sister Ida? Praise God. I just feel good here today. Feel good here today for every one of you. In Jesus' name. But God knows our hearts. Man looks on the outward appearance, but God looks on the heart. And you have to know that God will never leave you nor forsake you, but go with you all the way, even to the end of the world. You got to know He's never, ever, ever, ever turned His back on His children. Praise the Lord.